All right, so I'm here with my friends Ross and Jill Ramsey. We often talk about the dynamic of the call of God in ministry, and so Ross is transitioning to a new opportunity, and their family will still be part of our church family, but serving in a different ministry that still overlaps with us a lot. So Ross, share with our folks, this is where God has led. What you're going to be doing?
We got a call from E3, which is a mission organization here in Dallas. Some people might better know it as I Am Second. And they said, hey, Ross, would you be willing to come and join us and help us train our organization and also go to churches and conventions and seminaries and train them in this gospel conversation training and also help us train other churches around the United States in what you've been doing?
E3 drops this on you.
Absolutely.
Like throws a grenade in the room. How do you start processing that?
Well, it really wasn't a grenade. It was a grenade in one sense, but it was really an affirmation. We've been training in churches and training our church, and we've formed these groups and seen people come out of the harvest. And God began to say, I want you to take another step of faith, Ross. And so we just waited in prayer. And then one day I get this call from this mission organization. And they sell me on exactly what I've been doing for the last 4.5 years, saying they want to train 1 million people. And then I'm like, I'm all in. And then they say, Ross, there is one caveat. This is self-funding. And that blew my circuits. But for me, it was an absolute alignment with everything that God was doing in my heart. And I knew that He was calling me to a next step of faith.
Okay, so Jill, I know that you guys, you have a wonderful marriage and you're on the same page about all things, right?
Always.
Well, so Ross is contacted. Ross, we need you to do these things. Well, then you know that you are also caught up in the flow of this. This isn't a Ross thing and good luck with that while we're doing life over here. So how does this calling impact your life?
It totally changes our family like routine and dynamic and just our stability and our security in a lot of ways. And so when he initially called me and told me about it, at first I was like, well, praise the Lord, he answered our prayer. We've been praying, trying to figure this out, and he seemed to have peace that this is what it is. But I did go into my normal wife mode of 1 million questions.
I can only say I just felt this peace, Chad. I felt this total peace, like, this is what I want you to do. I want you to step out of the boat, and I want you to trust me. I felt this. I immediately called Jill, and she's like, okay, what happened? And I said, I think this is what I'm supposed to do. And she goes, I think you're right. And I thought she was going to talk me back off the cliff, right? She didn't do that. A couple more minutes into the phone call, we started talking about something else. And this is how she ended it. She goes, well, you know what? You follow God, so I'm going to follow you. I'm like, you're going to put that on my plate?
But it's on his head, right?
But you know what? It was just a real affirmation that God was kind of working both ends to the middle. And when she said that, it was just a real like, okay, I can do this. And that was a real turning point, a moment for me. Right about that time, the faith sermon, and I took every one of those examples in chapter 11, and I said, okay, the first one was a belief that God created the universe. Next time, they didn't do something, they hid their kid, right? Moses' parents. Yeah. Next one, they did this. And I just saw all examples of how faith is manifested in the life of a believer. And for me, I was like, there it is. It was just all converging. And if I walked from this, I knew I'd be disobedient.
So the two of you are working through all these things. You're seeing God's voice and all those things. Then you have 3 kids. How does that factor into this?
Well,
they're getting to be older kids.
Yeah, and they're getting more expensive. They need things.
It's strange. Driving and going to college.
They're very expensive in that regard. I remember I was talking to someone about this, what we were going to do, and they looked at me and they go, that is so wonderful. Your kids get to walk through this and see this step of faith. And it really convicted me because I had spoken to them about it. But at that moment, I went back home with Jill and I said, we really have to lay this out for them because this is just as much as a step of faith for them as it is me.
We just got around the family table and just said, this has come to us and we need y'all to be praying for us. What do you think about it? And of course, they had the normal kid concerns like, are we going to move away? Are we going to leave the church? Or, you know, those practical things. But I think the fact that they've been involved with us in the trainings and going to churches and training people it seemed to be, yeah, this is, and they all were excited to have a part in it and to hopefully do ministry as a family and do, you know, keep doing trainings as a family together. Back up to a year ago with COVID, I think we all were kind of soul searching and seeking, you know, it was such a strange time, you know, it made us question our purpose in life and if this is what we want to keep doing, what do we need to do better? What do we not want to do anymore when things return to normal? And we just kept coming back to the verse, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Not you can kind of please God a little bit, but it's impossible. And so I think through discussions, through praying together and reading our Bible together, we knew we had to take another step of faith in some area of our life. We knew it had just been comfortable and complacent and that we really weren't trusting God for anything big in our lives.
Yeah. So God stirs a holy discontent that there's something that's, I'm not settled where I am. Then you look at an opportunity, you see spiritual markers, because it all starts lining up with your praying and the scriptures and your passions that God's planted in you. It starts moving forward. And then that phrasing, the crisis of belief.
Absolutely.
The crisis of belief, because it's one thing to, that's an awesome idea. It's another thing to say, and now we're taking that crazy step. So, crisis of belief, Jill.
You are always talking about taking our next step with Christ, and there's always a next step for everybody to take. And we teach the stories of people in the Bible who did it, and we talk about it, but to actually, like, do it.
Yeah.
Well, and that was important that we knew that this next step was going to require faith. It was to experience Him on another level. And He couldn't have said it any clearer. This is your step of faith.
So in the dynamic of change and dealing with change, your office won't be here at the church anymore, but you guys are still planning to be a part of First Baptist Church, Allen. And so what is that going to look like around here? A lot of people have been asking about that.
No, we don't want to unplug. Our life is here. And so, the first thing that comes to my mind is our group. We love our group. We love these people. We've been ministering. And so we're going to stay with our group. We're going to continue to multiply leaders, meet every Sunday. We're still going to go into the harvest because we love that. We're going to still work with some of the students because our kids are over there.
We are deeply, deeply grateful for First Baptist Allen. I mean, you guys have poured into our lives, is it 9 years almost now?
Yeah.
And discipled our kids and loved on our family and brought us meals when we've been in the hospital. And there is no way we would ever want to leave this body of Christ unless God clearly told us, you know, we were needed somewhere else.
So the big difference is you'll still be here doing the things you do on Sunday morning, except if someone's looking for their Sunday school books or they need help with their video or they're wondering why the air's too hot or too cold in their room, you're not their guy
anymore.
I'll
send them to you, Chad.
Send them to me.
Right,
exactly.
I'll send them your way.
I'll pass them to Jimmy Smith. So
yeah, right.
He loves that stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
In our in-person services last week, we prayed briefly. And in-person services this Sunday, we're going to be praying, gathering around Ross and Jill. But for this online time, I want to lead in prayer for them. Just now invite you to join in prayer for them, not just in this moment, but in the days ahead. And there are ways you can partner with them and encourage them in real tangible ways, financially and otherwise. And I really want to encourage you in those next steps for you in partnering in ministry too. So let's pray. Father, I pray for my brother and sister in Christ, Ross and Jill, and for their kids. And Lord, I thank you for their sensitivity to your voice and your willingness to obey and their desire to walk closely with you, abiding. And Lord, I pray that you would protect them and cover them and walk with them closely, and they would know your constant presence and your abundant provision. And they would know, Father, that they are where you want them to be. And you would give them regular affirmations in the journey, and especially on the front end of this. I pray that labors for the harvest, as this would multiply and be magnified in ways that in the end the only way that it could be described is that God, who delivered a bunch of Hebrew slaves from Egypt, God who parted the Red Sea, God who raised Jesus from the dead, that same God is at work today. And you, God, receive all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.